Szanowni Państwo, dzisiaj naszym gościem jest pan Scholtenberg. Nasz gość jest przewodniczącym Komisji Spraw Zagranicznych w Parlamencie Węgierskim. Jest jednym z założycieli Fideszu, przez 10 lat był wiceprzewodniczącym tej partii i tak naprawdę, to warto podkreślić, jest bliskim współpracownikiem premiera Orbana. I w przeszłości pełnił również przez wiele lat funkcję sekretarza stanu w Ministerstwie Spraw Zagranicznych. Tytuł wykładu, spotkanie jest Hungarian Vision on the European Foreign and Security Policy. I tak tytułem wstępu powiem, chciałbym zwrócić uwagę na kilka spraw. No, wiadomo, że problem bezpieczeństwa jest palący współcześnie nie tylko z powodu takiego szczególnego natężenia problemów, jakim jest migracja, to, co się dzieje w ostatnich miesiącach w Europie, ale także zagrożenie militarne na wschodzie, także bezpieczeństwo energetyczne. Znamy potencjalne zagrożenia dla naszego bezpieczeństwa i korzystając z takiej typologii Donalda Rumsfelda, moglibyśmy powiedzieć, że znamy znane, nieznane. Ale bardziej niepokojące jest to, że istnieją zagrożenia, które nie są łatwo dostrzegalne i nie są też dostrzegane przez uważnych obserwatorów. Donald Rumsfeld nazwałby to jako nieznane, nieznane. I to, co warto też podkreślić, czasami są też te zagrożenia, o których część polityków nie chce słyszeć i z uporem pomija. Kryzys finansowy 2008 roku zwrócił uwagę mainstreamowych analityków, wielu dziedzin, nie tylko ekonomii, na fakt, że te mało prawdopodobne na pozór wydarzenia mają czasem bardzo wielki wpływ ostatecznie na to, jak wygląda nasz świat i także te wydarzenia zmieniają nasze oczekiwania, co właściwie jest możliwe, co jest prawdopodobne. Nie możemy zatem pomijać tych mało prawdopodobnych wydarzeń i czynników, myśląc o bezpieczeństwie naszych krajów, szczególnie w kontekście tego, co kiedyś było nie do pomyślenia, czyli naruszalności granic i tego, co widzieliśmy na wschodzie Europy, na Ukrainie. W tym kontekście współpraca Polski i Węgier, krajów naszego regionu, jest szczególnie ważna. Istnieje co prawda pewna odmienność w perspektyw rozłożenia akcentów, ale wierzę jednak w to, że współpraca Węgier i Polski jest korzystna nie tylko dla całego regionu, ale również dla Polski i Węgier. Także kończąc, dziękuję bardzo za obecność, za przybycie i oddaję panu głos.
Thank you very much for the invitation, ladies and gentlemen. It is sure a commonplace in this institute.
Please speak to the microphone. Translator cannot get your words.
All right. Okay. So it is sure a commonplace at this institute, but it is timely to recall and start with the fact that Sobieski defended Vienna, and Sobieski liberated two Hungarian cities on the two sides of the river Danube, Esztergom and Parkány, the latter with his mounted statue today on the Slovak side. This is one of the events out of the many where the Polish and the Hungarian history meets. Our history is quite rich in these meeting points. These very days we are commemorating the 1956 revolution. We are just coming from the Hungarian embassy, the reception. Many of you have been present. So our common Central European mission is expressed, found in action, posed at Hungarians together at that time against the Ottoman Empire. The figure of Sobieski is somehow relaxing. The fact that spiritually he's hosting us tonight gives us a good starting point and also perspective to our common thinking today. First of all, I would like to congratulate to the Polish nation to their clear decision to establish a new government with an open and stable parliamentary background led by PiS. A strong Polish government means a strong Central Europe, and a strong Central Europe means strong Hungary as well, since Central Europe is the home to many Polish, Hungarian, Czech, Slovak, Romanian, Latvian, Estonian, and other nations. Although the Hungarian Fidesz, which, as it was said, I am one of the founding fathers and I represent here, and the PiS are not in the same family of the European political map, yet they stand on the foundation of more than similar values, thus they can be called relatives or brothers, and are obviously natural allies to each other. Express z Budapesta dotarł do Warszawy. That's, the other surprising element of the weekend elections is the fallout of the left side. The heirs of the Socialist Party, which marks the end of an era, hopefully, a very, very long post-communist period, which has last really nearly over actually 25 years. I happily accepted the invitation to the Sobieski Institute. I am glad for the initiative because I read as a sign that there is a curiosity about Hungary. There are people who wish to understand what is going on in Hungary and for what reasons, especially in foreign policy, which is obviously a field closest to me. This is also essentially needed to consider the possibility of the perspective of cooperation between the freshly elected Polish government and for the 5.5 years ruling Hungarian government. And I would like to welcome Piotr Naimski, the head of the Hungarian-Polish friendship group in the SEIM, and whom we have started to consider the different modalities of the cooperation between the future Polish-Hungarian governmental cooperation. I would like to start where the Fidesz started in 2010 with the lead of Prime Minister and Party President Viktor Orban. In 2010, we closed the period of 8 years of socialist government with much turbulence in the government and society. Exactly 8 years we had to close. Economically, the socialists took out a large sum of loan from the IMF and burdened the Hungarian economy with a very heavy heritage. For example, we were balancing on the edge like Greece, and the solutions recommended by the West were similar to the socialist practice, austerity and more austerity. That was further worsened by the increasing government gross debt, 85% of GDP by 2010, the highest among the Visegrad states. Just for the comparison, I will draw your attention that in 2002, when the first Fidesz government gave over the government to the socialists, this data, the gross debt, was at 52%. So throughout 8 years, from 52% the debt amounting to 81%. And the budget deficit hit a bottom in 2006 with 9.4% of the GDP. The socialist government made the Swiss franc low risk, low interest slogan, these type of home loans, very popular, accepted, we can say, a common practice in wide ranges of the society. That's what like the public debt that doubled in a personalized form. Year by year it grew exponentially, it shot up in the sky by 2010 and reached 2,800 billion forints, which is roughly around 10 billion euros, which is approximately 7.7% of the Hungarian GDP. Social problems also generated problems in society. Unemployment rate went high up, it moved around 11%, while minimum wages were depressingly low. Murders against Roma citizens happened in a series. The agencies were incapable to stop the killings in a row. Even a small child fell victim of this blind racist running amok. A Hungarian village, Olaszliska, became ill-famed for a tragedy that Roma people beat to death a teacher who traveled with his family in their car and caused a minor accident. In response, the bystander relatives murdered him. His children and wife were eyewitnesses to this killing. These two accidental examples depict the situation. There was a kind of ethnic war in the air. Hungary accumulated a disadvantage in the field of foreign policy as well, compared to V4 countries. I would like to draw your attention, for example, the debates concerning the pipelines, the Nabucco and the South Stream pipelines debate. It reflected a very fundamental orientational debate in the Hungarian foreign policy. Generally, we went down a slide that generations of the Polish people couldn't have imagined between 2002 and 2010. Our perspectives were really dark, and that was the point when the socialists gave us back the lead country. I tell you, we became depressed when we faced the real numbers. That was quite shocking. The Hungarian society reacted to the situation by giving Fidesz a very strong mandate, a majority to form the government alone, which was a sign of trust on the one hand and was an enormous responsibility on the other. Probably the situation is getting hour by hour well known here. Along with the dilemmas such situation generates. Governing in alone, in majority, is a massive responsibility. The number one question was how to use this authority, what to do with this mandate. Are we able to lead the country out of this dead-end situation? At this point, Fidel decided to say no for mere austerity measures and try to come out of the negative spiral. No Greece in Hungary, we could say today. We had one strategic objective, to turn these economic tendencies, which I have depicted, around. But for that, one need a basis for economic growth. The liberal economy has obviously failed. That became clear from the depression. We quit the socialist practice. A third way we worked out was relying on our own sources. The basic idea thus was to restore the Hungarian national economic autonomy as much as possible. An economically independent Hungary is the alpha and omega of a sovereign state and the ground for our security. We paid back the IMF loans, and with that we created some elbow room for the Hungarian economy. We wanted to put together the building elements of the Hungarian economy ourselves and wished to avoid the IMF recommendations. We didn't want to sacrifice social workers, government employees, like teachers, like in Romania, they have to sacrifice. family is health care. Our vision was a healthy, optimistic, and proud society. In the field of social measures, we supported families and provided them with massive personal income tax deduction in order to turn the very negative demographic tendencies around. You may have bad demographic trends as well in Poland, but the Hungarian numbers are even worse. We have 1.3 fertility ratio in Hungary. We recorded a law against hate speech, forbade the so-called National Guard of the Jobbik, which we can discuss later if you wish, far-right party. The right-wing Fidesz was, the center-right Fidesz was the only who acted against, in this way, effectively, against anti-Semitism. Socialist and liberal governments only spoke about increase the dangers. We provide the Jewish community with an atmosphere that helps them flourish, and they do flourish. For example, the Wallenberg year, which was I was lucky to chair. He was the Hungarian Jews Schindler. The Holocaust year, the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance year, which Hungary presides, mark this intention. And we renovate synagogues not only in Hungary, but throughout the whole Carpathian Basin. That means in neighboring countries as well. Our social inclusion program for the Roma people set an example in the EU. As Hungary was the chairman of the European Union Council in the first half of 2011. We witness a kind of social reconciliation, no racism-motivated murders, no actions against migrants like stones throwing or setting camps on fire. We organized events which were impossible to realize before, and which couldn't be organized, for example, in France without serious police cover, like Jewish festivals, klezmer music festivals. Budapest is going to host the Jewish Olympics, the European Maccabi Games. We are witnessing a kind of Jewish revival in Hungary. Concerning the economic measures, yet we needed to fill the gaps in the state budget, because we didn't want to overburden the society, we levied tax on certain major tech sectors, on the banks, insurance companies, and we took these measures basically against monopolies. The price for this was really high. We harmed plenty of different interests this way and earned loads of enemies and heated criticism, especially reflected in the global media. The budget deficit is now 2.5%. We expect an economic growth for this year 2.6%, and we fall down the government's gross debt again to 75% GDP, which is 5% less than in 2010. We led Hungary out of the excessive deficit procedure. 14 out of the 28 EU members are still in this procedure, meaning that half of them still is having more than 3% deficit. We converted the foreign exchange loans into foreign debt and renegotiated it with the banks in favor of the bankrupt families. We stopped forcing people out of their homes. We introduced a program which leads from welfare benefits into social work. Unemployment rate went down from 11% to 6.7% as of today. I will not tell all the details, but these measures generated much critique in Europe. Clashes between the Hungarian government and large Western European firms and caused the presently overall negative picture still. We have to tell that about Hungary in Europe. However, we are acknowledged in Hungary by the Hungarian people. Fidesz was re-elected for the second parliamentary period with a mandate. Again, we could get 2/3 of the parliamentary seats. And last year, we won all 3 elections, the parliamentary, the European parliamentary, and the local elections with a very similar landslide victory character. A few words about the relation between economy and security. Does all that what I said for so far mean that Hungary is ready to sacrifice security for economy? I raise this question quite artificially because it is related with the Russian policy of the Orban cabinet, and I do not want to avoid that sensitive issue, especially in Warsaw. I guess many suppose that this is what happened, that Orban sacrificed security on the altar of economy. That assumption implies the denial of the relation between economy and security. An economically weak, thus socially unstable state is exposed to foreign influence. Thus, eliminating the Hungarian economic social crisis was definitely a security question from the Hungarian perspective. But it is also a security question from the regional point of view. Central Europe is the Western background, for example, to the Ukraine. If Central Europe is stable, it gives a chance for the Ukraine to stabilize its own independence. By and large, the same is true to the Balkans, which we are neighboring and which is equally an important adjacent region to Central Europe. Thus, we are convinced that the Hungarian social economic stabilization is a general Central European, moreover, a European interest. To be sure, it is a Polish interest as well. Just have a quick look at the example of the faraway Greece. Instability over there imposes a direct threat on us here in Central Europe.